أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين بارئ الخلائق أجمعين باعث الأنبياء والمرسلين ثم الصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وطبيب نفوسنا وشفيع ذنوبنا أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين المنتجبين لا سيما بقية الله في الأراضين روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. For the hastening the return of our Imam, please recite the salawat. We've tried to, by the grace of God and His blessings, go over some of what I felt necessary in the process of us trying to work, have that practical dua, call upon the Imam of our time to come, not just verbally, not just through words, but rather also through actions, through the things that we do. We want to make sure that when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us this great blessing, that we will inshallah enjoy once He arrives and see what the difference will be between when He is not present and when He is amongst us. When we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that great blessing, that we take the appropriate steps towards it as well, so that we can try to make that dua something that will be fulfilled. We talked about us trying to work together, do things, mobilize, and I hope we see that actually happening, because otherwise we can come and talk about this all we want, but if it doesn't really turn into something practical, it's meaningless. It's a waste of time. What was said and what was heard is down the drain because it didn't really result in anything. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us try to put this in action, inshallah. What we tried to cover over the course of these days that have passed was the practical side of it from a collective perspective, doing things, mobilizing, moving in the right direction, uniting on that front, and so on and so forth. What I'd like to start discussing from tonight onwards is something that is slightly different. It's related to the same discussion. It is very, very connected with it, but it addresses it from a different perspective. And that is that we shouldn't neglect ourselves. We should not, in doing and taking part of this social mobilizing and moving and doing things, coming together, coming to the center, setting up programs, trying to invite others, trying to put on courses, trying to bring more people into Islam, into Shia Islam, and getting people mobilized. When we're doing all of that, it should not lead us to forget about ourselves. Okay. There are two groups of people that do this in the wrong way. Some of the believers who are practicing, they are believers, they do like Islam, they do pray, they do their responsibilities. They only take care of their responsibilities from a very personal perspective. In other words, they're interested, for example, in spirituality. They like all the talks that you can find on getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dhikr, Quran, etiquettes, how to be kind to your neighbors. They like all of that stuff. But when it comes to the social side of it, when it comes to mobilizing, doing things, participating, they don't want to be part of it. Okay. We have believers that are like that, which is not correct. This is not the right way to do things. Islam does not only cover that form of spirituality. But then we have another group of people, unfortunately, that go the other direction, the other wrong direction. And that is, they get so involved with community work They get so involved with organizing programs, trying to invite speakers, trying to arrange the different elements which are necessary to get that program running, networking, going to different conferences, and so on and so forth, always online, on this forum, on the other forum, just typing up stuff. They're very active, but when it comes to their own souls, their own nufus, we don't see them very active and very involved. This is also wrong. It's equally or even worse. It's equally wrong or even worse than the group of people who are not active in social work. We cannot leave this. Let me give this to us with a verse or a few verses of the Holy Quran. If we're talking about, in the context, let's not forget, is us preparing for the coming of our beloved Imam. We want to prepare for this. And this social mobilizing has got to involve spirituality, iman, faith, the increase of that as well. It can't be without that. It's going to be incomplete and very dangerous. What I want to read of the Holy Quran and try to give you a very brief translation to begin the discussion is Surat Al-Ahzab. Surat Al-Ahzab is a very interesting surah of the Holy Quran. What verses 9 through, I believe, 26, 27 discuss the battle of Ahzab, and that's why it is referred to as Surat Al-Ahzab. Okay, the battle of Ahzab. Some of us know this battle as the battle of Khandaq, okay, the trench. Right, where they dug the trench and the believers were one side, the disbelievers, the kuffar, were on the other side, and then Amr ibn Abdu'ad came over to this side, and the battle, you know, between Amir al-Mu'mineen and this kafir, which Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi was victorious in, and the battle ended shortly after. We've heard about this story, we've heard about this battle, but we don't know a lot of the good details of this battle, which are beneficial for us to know, and they teach us a lot in regards to what we need to do. Unfortunately, sometimes when we hear about the stories of this battle or other battles, there's really nothing to learn from it. Okay, because none of us are going to be swinging the sword around or going and killing anybody with the sword when we tell the story of Amir al-Mu'mineen winning over Amr ibn Abdu'ud. Okay, there's nothing really practical that we can take. It's just feeling great about Amir al-Mu'mineen, which is good. It's good to hear it every once in a while. But there's a lot more to the story. There's a lot that can be benefited from that we have to learn. The verses, verse 9 begins like this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu dhkuru ni'matallahi alaykum idh ja'atkum junudun فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ رِيحًا وَجُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَّا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرًا. It begins with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about His ni'mah, a blessing that God provided for the believers. Okay. An unseen army of angels. جُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا. He did not see these angels, the army of the angels. And there was a wind that came and helped the believers. I don't want to get into those and explain what those exactly are. This is where it begins. Then it says, إِذْ جَاءُوكُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ. The kuffar. They came to you, مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ. Above Medina, from the north, are the Jews. Okay, the Jews that had treaties with the Holy Prophet so that they would not be fighting the Holy Prophet, joining any other camp, any army to fight the Prophet. These Jews joined the rest of the Kuffar in fighting the Holy Prophet. They went against their treaty that they had with the Holy Prophet. وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ. From beneath, the Kuffar of Mecca gathered all the tribes. All right. Previously, there was the Battle of Badr. It was mainly Quraysh from Mecca. All right. Now, though, they have all the tribes coming and fighting the Holy Prophet. All of them have gathered. They're coming from beneath, and from up north you have the Jews. So they're surrounded. The believers are surrounded. إِذْ جَاءُكُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ وَإِذْ زَاغَتِ الْأَبْصَارُ وَبَلَغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ الْحَنَاجِرُ وَتَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَ. At this point, the believers were freaking out. Okay. It is very, very scary. And this is really, you know, they were seriously freaking out. Okay. Because they're completely surrounded. And the kuffar, the mushrikeen, the Jews are coming with all the force, and they have nothing in Medina. Their numbers are very few. That fear that is created in their hearts, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing here, leads them, وَتَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ أَظُنُونَ. They start to have doubts with regards to God Himself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues, He says, هُنَالِكَ ابْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. This is when the believers were tested and they were shaken very harshly. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests. If you want to follow the footsteps of the Ahlul Bayt, if you want to take those social steps as well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to be testing. There will be very, very difficult times. Part of it is people being stopped at airports, and all of this is just the beginning, brothers and sisters. Okay. Having visits from our friends in the FBI, okay, this is just the beginning. There's going to be more of this. There will be. If we want to move in the right direction, the enemies of Allah, the enemies of humanity, the enemies of the Holy Prophet in Islam are going to be stepping up the pressure. There is going to be more and more pressure. زُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. What happens? وَإِذْ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. The munafiqeen, according to the verse, they say that مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. All the promises that God had made and His Prophet, the Messenger, made, all of that was just baloney. Okay. There was no reality to it. God promised victory. Promised that this religion will prevail on the face of the earth. Now they're seeing, they're surrounded, they don't have anything. All of the kuffar are coming forward. They really have no escape. There is no escape. They're completely outnumbered. This is not like even the Battle of Badr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about munafiqeen here. When you look at the tafasir, the mufassireen, the ulama have mentioned that these munafiqeen are not the ones that were intentionally trying to be bad, really disbelieving at heart and portraying themselves as believers. This is not the munafiqeen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about here. Those are other verses that talk about those munafiqeen. They say these munafiqeen are the ones that are weak believers. Those who have not worked on themselves. That weakness in faith, the wrong moment is going to come in and is going to shake the foundations of your faith. When pressure, when you start feeling the pinch, when difficulty comes around, then that weakness in faith is going to show itself. As long as nobody is giving you any trouble, you can chant all the Hezbollah chants, all of that, put up all the pictures you want of all of the ulama, the revolutionary ulama, all of that. But then when they start coming and scrutinizing you, then who's going to be there? During the time when you had that ease, who built their faith? Who has that strength in faith? In Iman. Recite the salawat, please.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
It says, وَقَالَتْ طَائِفَةٌ منهم يا أهل يثرب لا مقام لكم فارجعوا. Some of them, these are the believers in Medina. Some of them are telling others, they're weakening the other people's faith as well, the other brothers and sisters, like, look, we better not stay here, let's get the heck out of here, let's leave, let's escape. This happens amongst us, something like that happens, like shut everything down. Don't even have pictures of our ulama. I've seen this, right? I've seen people being, when nobody's getting on their case, having pictures of ulama like Sayyid Hassan Nasrullah or Ayatollah Khamenei, Imam Khomeini, all these things, chanting slogans. Then when the pressure comes, you can't even take Ayatollah Khamenei's picture into the masjid. Like, no, this is a no-no here. Okay. Same people. So the verses continue, they explain, these are one set of believers, some of the believers which are weak in faith, they haven't built their faith strong. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse 22 talks about the real believers, people who have built their faith strong. And it's really, really amazing the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about them. He says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم ولما رأى المؤمنون الأحزاب. The disbelievers, they got news that people are gathering together and all the mushrikeen are coming together to fight the believers. They started freaking out and they started saying loads of things. Their faith in God and God's promises started to be questioned. And then afterwards, let me read this before I explain because it's important. It says, recite the salawat, please. فَإِذَا جَاءَ الْخَوْفُ رَأَيْتَهُمْ يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَيْكَ تَدُورُ أَعْيُنُهُمْ كَالَّذِي يُغْشَى عَلَيْهِ مِنَ الْمَوْتِ. When fear comes, difficult times, you look at them, they're almost about to faint, that scared. Their eyes are just going around. But then, فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ الْخَوْفِ, when the enemy is gone, when the kuffar finally left, they come to you, فَإِذَا ذَهَبَ الْخَوْفِ سَلَقُوكُمْ بِأَلْسِنَةٍ حِدَادٍ أَشِحَّةً عَلَى الْخَيْرِ. When the fear is gone, now they come up very bravely. Yeah, alhamdulillah, God helped us. Chanting slogans again, all hopeful of everything. You should have been hopeful, you should have been chanting when the fear was there. So the disbelievers, when there is pressure, the ones who don't have that strong faith, when there's pressure, they lose it. When things get back to normal again a little bit, and you see them up and running again. But the believers, says, وَلَمَّا رَأَى الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الْأَحْزَابِ. When the believers saw these ahzab coming towards them, they see the mushrikeen, they get the news, they see them, they go up and they see, yeah, these guys are coming. Abu Dha, Salman, Miqdad, Amirul Mu'mineen, Salamullah alayhi, above all. They see this, they're sitting down planning how we're going to do this, how we're going to meet them. They dig the trench. They're getting prepared for all of this, but they're watching them coming, all right? That large mass of the enemy coming forward. Reminds you of Karbala, see? Many people left Imam al-Hussein on the battlefield of Karbala. They couldn't take it. Weak faith. Weak belief. It's pretty difficult when you get 120 maybe maximum number of people that are around Imam al-Hussein. Some say 72, there's different figures. 100, 200, let's say, against 35,000 people. That's one of the accurate figures that we have. One of the accurate figures. 35,000 people. Right. Obviously, there's no win out of that. Okay. There's no way you can get out of that alive. And Imam Hussein told them, tomorrow whoever stays is going to go for shahada. If you're up for it, you're willing to stand, stay back. Otherwise, leave. Because that's what's going to happen tomorrow. People chickened out. They left. They don't have this faith. Says lamma ra'a al-mu'minuna al-ahzab qalu hadha ma wa'adana Allah wa rasuluhu wa sadaqa Allah wa rasuluhu. Allahu akbar. When they see the enemy coming, they say, this is exactly what God promised us. Bring it on. Give me more. I'm waiting for it. I've been told, if I have real faith, you guys should be coming and trying to fight me. I'm not afraid of this. I signed up for it. True faith is like this. There's no fear. No fear from anything. If the iman is built up, if the faith is built up in one. I don't know if you've heard that story or not, but they say this speaker, Ajay Qiraati, I heard it from him, but others have also confirmed this. When they came to pick Imam Khomeini up to take him for prison or exile, one of the two, some of the top generals of the Shah were there to pick him up. Okay, top generals. And this is 15 years before the revolution. For your information, if you didn't know, the entire region was being influenced by the Shah's regime in Iran. Okay, read that history and learn about it. The Saudis, the Khalij governments, none of these guys were anything compared to Iran at that time, because the Americans had invested in Iran and given them all the warfare and what have you. And the Iranians were doing exactly what the Americans wanted them to do. So they had all that power. The Iranian army is pretty tough. It's something similar to the Egyptian army that you see right now, who's able to come in and just oust any president they want. They got a lot of power at that time. So these generals are coming to pick Imam Khomeini. Who is Imam Khomeini? Imam Khomeini is just an alim sitting in Qum, no army, no nothing. So they should be coming in with power and he should be scared. People who were there have reported this, said the generals were shivering. And Imam Khomeini very calmly comes out and goes with them. There's no fear. True faith has got to be built. What is this true faith? Recite the salawat, please.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us a little bit about this. I'm going to use a few verses to try to explain this very briefly. Surah Baqarah, verse 153, excuse me. It begins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala begins to discuss this. Surah Al-Baqarah is the first surah that's revealed, or the majority of the verses, are the first verses that are revealed upon the heart of the Holy Prophet when he moves to Medina. Verse 153, he says, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة إن الله مع الصابرين. O those who believe, or all you who believe, استعينوا بالصبر والصلاة. Take advantage of and make use of patience and salah. Okay. Prayer. Inna Allaha ma'a as-sabirin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with the patient. When you look at this verse compared to the verses before this, you see that there's a change in tone. Okay. And there's a reason for it. Because this verse is the beginning of a few verses speaking to the believers, getting them ready for their first battles. Okay, when the Holy Prophet came to Medina, there was no battles in Mecca. In Medina, gradually they started getting involved with battles, okay, fighting. Battles, war, that's not easy. There's going to be difficulties. So before it begins, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells the believers, you guys have to start practicing patience. Patience is going to be very, very important. Okay, very important. I'm going to talk about patience a little bit in one of the verses that follows. So it starts talking about this, and it says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَن يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتًا. You have to get your mind straight about somebody who dies in battle for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anybody dies in battle for the sake of Allah, they're not dead. You don't really die بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. They are alive, you just don't know that. Okay, so preparing them and preparing their mindsets, one of the things that is said about the true Muslim fighters is that there's no fear of death. They welcome it. Okay, and that makes them soldiers that you really cannot fight. You cannot get them off that field. Okay, they're very dangerous soldiers. So this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving the believers this. Then he says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. We will test you with loss of, or with fear, first he says, وَالْجُوعِ, and with hunger, and with loss of property, wealth, your belongings, you're going to lose them. You're going to have to invest. وَالْأَنفُسِ, you will have lives that are going to be lost on this way. You will have that. Okay. It's impossible. It's part of the game. وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. There's a difference of opinion about what ثَمَرَات means. Some say it's fruit, some say it's offspring. وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give good tidings to الصَّابِرِينَ, the patient. Who are the patient? Let me first explain the patients, and then I'll read the verse which most of you, if not all of you, would be familiar with. Patience is explained in one hadith in a very, very beautiful way. It gives us the example of a ship. A ship that is riding in very dangerous waters. There's storms coming, big waves coming, right? Big waves coming, storm coming, and it causes the ship to try to, or to move around. It's very, very difficult to control the ship. There's a certain destination that it's moving towards. Okay? It sets out to sea to reach a certain destination. On the way, there's a storm and very wavy waters and so on and so forth. It's difficult to control that ship. It's difficult to move in the right direction. It says that sabr and patience is holding on to the steering wheel, not allowing it to change direction. Okay, there's a right thing to do, there's always a correct thing for us to do, and then the difficulties of life come and make us want to bend one way or the other. If you hold on and continue on your path, continue moving forward, that's when one has patience. Patience doesn't mean wait. Patience means continue doing the right thing. And don't bend, don't change your course because of the difficulties. That's what patience means. How are you able to do that? What gives us the ability to be patient? The verse afterwards explains. It says, الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. This verse, they say, is revealed with regards to Amir al-Mu'mineen, Salamu Allah. We say salawat. They say Amir al-Mu'mineen was told about one of his friends being killed in battle, and he said these words, "Inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un." Right. And whenever we're told of this, then what we gather from it, what we take from it, is that being patient means that if they tell you somebody, some of your relatives, one of your relatives passed away, then you gotta say, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un." That's not patience. Patience isn't saying these words. Qalu okay. Here doesn't mean they verbally say it. It says this is their belief. This is the way they feel. This is their understanding of the world around them. And that is, inna lillah wa inna ilayhi raji'un. This is what we have to gather in our hearts. This is what we have to increase in our hearts. This is the way we have to see things. Inna lillah. We are belonging to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are God's property. Everything in this universe belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without exception. Okay. Everything belongs to Allah. What does this ownership mean? لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ. If you look at the verses of the Holy Quran, there's plenty of times that this is repeated. Let's try to look at the verses again and try to get a little deeper, understand things better than what we currently understand. What does ownership mean? What's the meaning of it? We're talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala owns the lights here. He owns the building here. He owns the curtain here. He owns every single one of you. He owns me. All of us, every single molecule, every single atom, every single neutron, every single quartz in this world belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without exception. The meaning of that, briefly, if we try to have a better understanding, is that none of us are outside of God's jurisdiction, His authority. He does ownership. This is what it means. If you own a phone or a computer or an iPad or some tablet or whatever, you have control over it. You have authority over it. You decide what happens to it. Nobody else can do anything to it unless you allow it. You permit it. If you don't, then it's not going to happen. But it's an artificial ownership. It's not a real ownership. What do we mean by artificial and real ownership? Artificial ownership is, it's a contract. If you come and take this, there's no way I can prevent you. You'll take it, people steal things, right? It's stolen, it's gone. I used to own it, I don't even know where it is now. This is not real ownership, it's just a contract. We respect each other. If I have this, you consider it mine, you don't touch it unless I permit. And vice versa. If you have something, I'm not going to touch it. But there's no real relationship between the two. It's not really that this phone is going to do as I wish. They haven't gotten there, at least the technology hasn't, that I just think and I just want this to turn on. No, I have to touch that button for it to come on. If I don't touch the button, it's not going to come on. If I don't dial the numbers, it's not going to work. Even if I dial the numbers, but there's no network, it's not going to call. I don't have control over it. I don't have real control. It's very limited control that I have over what I own. But the ownership of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is full ownership. It's real ownership. Nothing in this universe is going to do other than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it to do. Nothing. No human being, no particle, no atom, no molecule, nothing will do anything unless Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants it. A knife will not cut if God doesn't want it to cut. You say, Prophet Ibrahim used the knife on Ismail. He used it. It's not like he went there and then they stopped him. No, he used it, but it wasn't cutting. Very sharp knife. I'm sure he sharpened it. It doesn't cut. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want it to cut, it will not cut, no matter what you do. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want you to be harmed, you will not be harmed. It doesn't matter who wants to do what. It's not going to happen. He will make it happen in a way where you live through it. And if He wants you to die, you will die, even if you escape all your enemies. He'll send some tiny virus or bacteria or something. One cough, 1 second, you're gone. If He wants to take your life, He'll take your life. There's no escape from it. And if He wants you to live, you will live, and there is no escape from it. Okay. This is the meaning of ownership. Imam Khomeini said something really nice. I don't know if you've heard about the story of the sandstorm. After the, what they refer to in America as the hostage crisis, which was very embarrassing to the American government, where their diplomats were being held in the Islamic Republic by some students, university students took them initially. It was very embarrassing. They asked for them back and they're like, well, we have some demands for us to release them. So they tried everything to get them back. One of the last tries and the last efforts they put was they sent a fleet, planes, helicopters, everything, and they planned it out very well, and they had even worked out the intelligence with the president of Iran at that time, the elected president of Iran, Bani Sa'd. He was part of the plan. They were going to come in Tehran, pick their hostages up and leave. End of story. Okay. Imam Khomeini didn't know about this. Sepah, the Revolutionary Guards, didn't know about this. Nobody knew about this, if there was a Revolutionary Guard at that time. Nobody knew about this. Except for the wrong people, they knew about this, and they had planned it out. Everything was working perfectly fine. And I think one of the things that we all know is forecasting the weather is one of those areas that they're very, very strong in. So they had all that under control as well. When they go in the deserts of Iran to go towards Tehran to get the hostages, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends out of nowhere a sandstorm. And it just destroys all the equipment. And almost all, I think, people die, gone. Imam Khomeini spoke afterwards. He said, people, take lesson from this. Who did this? Did we do it? Did we plan it? Did we, I don't know, have a big fan created the sandstorm? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps the believers. If He doesn't want it to happen, it will not happen. You can plan all you want. Okay. People can plan all they want. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't want it to happen, it will not happen. There's so many of these stories. Look at the verses of the Holy Quran, the stories of the Holy Quran, and try to learn the lesson from them. Many of these stories, if not all, are trying to tell us this very fact. Learn this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in control. Don't worry. He owns everything. If I have that belief, inna lillah, okay, I am belonging to God. Sometimes people mistranslate this to say we come from God and to Him do we return. No, that's not what it means. Inna lillah, we belong to Him. If somebody really understands that and really understands what ownership, God's ownership over everything, over myself, over everything and everyone that I know, what that actually means, then no matter how difficult things become, I continue moving on what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told me to move on. I'm not worried. The only thing you may be worried about is death. Well, that's the second part of the belief. وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. It's amazing what that again means. Some, again, they translate this that we return to Him. That's not an accurate translation. The accurate translation is to say we are returning to Him currently. Inna ilayhi raji'un. Raja is, grammatically they call it ismul fa'il, and they say the meaning of it is present tense, not the future. It's present. Inna ilayhi raji'un. We are currently moving towards Him. Every step we take, we're moving towards God, towards meeting Him, towards death. This is a very important belief to have. This is a belief that needs to be strengthened in the heart. The one that we want to mainly focus on is this idea of Tawheed. Okay. The only one being that has full control over everything is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This iman has to be strengthened in our hearts, brothers and sisters. If we want to be a true muntadhir, someone who's awaiting the coming of our imam, this has got to be strengthened in our hearts. We have to realize it. We have to see it. Recite a salawat, please.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
When we don't see that, the reverse of that, not seeing Tawheed, not seeing God's role in things, we start to fall under verse 41 of Surah Al-Ankabut. This is a very, very, very beautiful verse, if we understand it. إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. If we get to really understand the depths of this, It's an amazing verse. This is the verse for which the surah is referred to as Al-Ankabut. Ankabut means the spider. This verse is the verse that talks about the spider. Okay. And it's not a long story about a spider. Okay. It's something very different. What is it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ كَمَثَلِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ اتَّخَذَتْ بَيْتًا. If you don't see God in everything, and Him being in control of everything, naturally you're going to consider these other things as things that can do something for you, and you will rely on them. Whether it's believers in the community, whether it's people in the government, whether it's people elsewhere, whether it's technology, whatever it is, if you rely on them and don't see them as means provided to you by God, okay, you see a separation between them. That's what this verse says. الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ. These two ideas should not be mixed up, okay? It's not like you don't go to people, you don't plan things out, you don't use technology, you don't rely on the help of other people, no. But if it's part of your belief and understanding that this person is just put there by God, I'm supposed to use this means that is provided for me by God. This is one way to look at it. The other way to look at it is, I just see this person, I just see this device, I just see this planning, I don't see God in it. If I don't see God in it, that's when it becomes min dunillah. The verse says, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ كَمَثَلِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ اتَّخَذَتْ بَيْتًا. If you rely on anything except for God, other than God, okay, you don't see God in it, you're relying on something other than God. If you do that, says the example of that is like a spider spinning a web. Now there's all your plans are like the spider web. Alright? وَإِنَّ أَوْهَنَ الْبُيُوتِ لَبَيْتُ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. The weakest nest amongst all animals is a spider web. You just blow on it and it's gone. Okay. It's very weak. It spends a lot of time, all the intricate details, some of them are very, very beautiful if you've seen them. You know, it looks really nice, all the work that is done. And it takes a lot of time for it to be what it is. But all you need to do to destroy it is just blow on it. إِنَّ أَوْهَنَ الْبُيُوتِ لَبَيْتُ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ. All the plans that are made, all of the efforts that are made, and reliance on anything other than God is going to be like that spider web. It'll get destroyed very quickly. This teaches us two things. One is with regards to ourselves. If we don't see God, if we don't see that inna lillah that the other verse talked about, if we don't see our connection with Allah and our reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will naturally rely on other things, and that those other things are going to not work for us. Okay. But the other thing that it teaches us is something in the process of preparing for the Imam of our time is extremely important. Sometimes we look at the enemy of Islam, the enemies of Islam, and think they have everything under control. The Zionists have everything planned out already. They have the cameras here, surveillance, they know who's doing what. They control the American government, they control the Europeans, they control this, they control that, they control the Saudis, they control all the money, all the wealth, the bankers, this, that, the other. And we feel like we can't do anything. This verse is telling us. And the stories that are mentioned here are actually on the second point that I'm making. All of their plans, all of their plots, all of what they have that seems to be a great amount of influence, it's like a spider web. Okay. It's like a spider web. And examples of that are coming true every now and then. Okay. Every now and then. I don't know if you remember the Lebanon war in 06. They said that this Israeli war machine, the military is the fourth in the world or top in the region. They have the tanks and they have this and they have that and they have intelligence and so on and so forth. Sayyid Hassan Nasrullah, may Allah give him a long life, said before the war, he said, I swear, he said, Wallahi, all of this is la'awhan min bayt al-ankabut. Okay. It's weaker than a spider web. Took 33 days. They gave up. The soldiers were running from the battlefield. They were scared of, I don't know how many soldiers Hezbollah had on the field. They were running from the battlefield. Scared, saying Hezbollah fighters are ghost fighters, whatever. I remember reading, I don't know if you were reading at that time or not. The comments they were making. You think they have all that under control? They can't even fight 33 days with a guerrilla organization. Not even with an army. Next battle, Gaza, they're isolated. They have been cut off. They're under surveillance. They cannot move. 22 days, they gave up. The next war they fought, 8 days last year, I don't know if you remember that or not, in December actually. 8 days. It's done. These are signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for you to understand this. Don't think that they're really this big monster that can do so much. No, they can't do anything. لَأَوْهَنْ مِنْ بَيْتِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ. Anyone that relies on anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is أَوْهَنْ مِنْ بَيْتِ الْعَنْكَبُوتِ. So how do we develop this in us? Recite another salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
How do we do this? We need to work on ourselves, brothers and sisters, very, very seriously, to try to develop this spirit, this iman in us, inshallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Dhariyat has a very interesting few verses that we want to read and benefit from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in verse 15 of Surah Al-Dhariyat begins to say, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Innal muttaqeen fi jannatin wa uyun. Believers are muttaqeen, people who have faith and they avoid all the sins, fulfill all their obligations. These people are going to be in gardens and springs. It's picturing the hereafter, paradise. إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي جَنَّاتٍ وَعُيُونَ أَخِذِينَ مَا آتَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ. This is a very beautiful verse. I'll leave the explanation of how beautiful it is for those who are interested. It focuses on the idea that they're receiving everything from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that gives them the joy. Seeing it being given to them by God is what gives these believers joy. Just because it's from Him, it's joyful. أَخِذِينَ مَا آتَاهُمْ رَبُّهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَبْلَ ذَلِكَ مُحْسَنِينَ. Before that, they were muhsaneen. They did good. Then it begins to explain who they were and what this ihsan that they did. كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ. They used to sleep for short periods. وَبِالْأَسْحَارِهُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. They used to wake up for the night prayers. These are all instructions, brothers and sisters. Getting up before Fajr time, performing the night prayers. وَفِي أَمْوَالِهِمْ حَقٌّ لِلسَّائِلِ وَالْمَحْرُومِ. Charity, give. Don't allow that greed prevent you from giving. No. Sa'il, anyone who asks you for help, give them something. Don't let them go without you giving them something. Then it says, this is what I want to focus on. It says, وَفِي الْأَرْضِ آيَاتٌ لِلْمُقِنِينَ. These are very beautiful few verses if we understand. If we try to, and I encourage brothers and sisters going and reading this and trying to understand it further. وَفِي الْأَرْضِ آيَاتٌ لِلْمُوقِنِينَ. In the earth, there are signs for those who are looking for yaqeen. If you're looking for that faith, the earth is filled with ayat. You have to see everything as an ayat. You have to see God when you see the wind, when you see the clouds, when you see the sun, when you see sunset, when you see dawn. All of that, all of these are signs of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you look at the sky, you should see the signs of Allah. When you should see the trees, you see human beings. These are all ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we see them, lilmuqineen, someone who's looking for yaqeen. They keep looking, and the more they look, instead of just seeing people, instead of just seeing a human being, instead of just seeing sin, they see the sign of Allah. Instead of just seeing the wonders in the ocean and watching and saying, wow, this is so beautiful, they say, subhanallah. They see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they keep absorbing that. Their hearts keep absorbing that. وَفِي الْأَرْضِ آيَاتٌ لِلْمُوقِنِينَ وَفِي أَنفُسِهِمْ. In their anfus, in themselves, each and one of us, the closest sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we all have is ourselves, if we look within. If we open our eyes, the eyes of our hearts, it's a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That they say, the Urafa say, that's the closest sign, it's the closest one. The one that can get you to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quickest. If that door is opened on us, we should be looking for these signs. Then he says, أَفَلَا تُبْصِرُونَ. You don't want to look to see those signs, see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَفِي السَّمَاءِ رِزْقُكُمْ وَمَا تُوَعَدُونَ فَوَرَبِّ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ إِنَّهُ لَحَقٌ مِثْلَ مَا أَنَّكُمْ تَنْطِقُونَ. One of the ulama gave a very beautiful explanation of this. فَوَرَبِّ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. By the Lord of the heaven and the earth, إِنَّهُ لَحَقٌ. God is truth. He is a reality. مِثْلَ مَا أَنَّكُمْ تَنْطِقُونَ. The same way that you talk, when you speak, okay? When you speak, it's very, very primitive to think like they do out here, that you are this brain. They explain the human being in a very material way, where you are a combination of the molecules that form the cells, and that's it, that's you. That's not the case. We are our soul. He says, the same way that your soul makes this body move and you speak, okay, but it's the soul that makes this happen. إِنَّهُ لَحَقٌ مِثْلَ مَا أَنَّكُمْ تَنْتَقُونَ. Everything that happens around you, somebody said, give me evidence of God. Everything is evidence of God. Just open your eyes up. The same way that when you speak, you don't see that soul, you just see this body moving. And when you look within, you realize that soul that's making this happen. Think about that and understand that everything that happens, when that wind is blowing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is doing it. You just don't see Him Himself. You're seeing His action. We've got to open our eyes to these ayat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our faith. With that increased faith, we can be like those strong companions of Amir al-Mu'mineen and Imam al-Husayn, those who took arrows in front of Imam al-Husayn, and they weren't afraid of them when they came. They didn't fear the pain of the arrows coming towards them. In fact, they took them with their bodies when the shield was not enough. And they stood until the Imam finished his prayer. That takes a lot of faith. It takes a whole lot of faith. And I hope we get on this track and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the right of the Imam of our time, by the right of the Ahlul Bayt, that he hastens the return of our Imam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us become his true followers, his true companions. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to prolong the life of and give good health to all those who are helping the cause of Islam, especially the maraja and especially the leader. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us all of our sins. We ask them to forgive our parents, our relatives, all believers, those who are alive, those who have left this world, of their sins. We ask them to grant all the believers their needs, their requests. We ask them to cure all the ill from amongst the believers worldwide. And we ask them to relieve all the people of the world who are facing different forms of oppressions, inshallah. Bin Nabi wa Alih, rahimallah, man qara'a al-fatihata ma'as-salawat.